Hi everyone and welcome back to the Gyan from Pehlwan under our podcast FinTech Ki Baat Dil Se. Today we have Vishant Pant, who is the leading FinTech expert in India. Vishant, thank you so much for coming. It was it's a really an honor to have you here. आपसे हम ये जानना चाहते हैं कि you know since we have heard कि आप recently एक AIF fund form कर रहे हैं इंडिया में and you have been you have spoken with more than 2,000 startups in the period of last 2 to 3 years. तो आपने जो स्टार्टअप्स की पिचेस सुने हैं उसमें आप क्या क्या गलतियां देखते हैं, व्हाट आर द कॉमन मिस्टेक्स एज अ वीसी, आप क्या देखते हैं, किस तरह आप उनको रिजॉल्व करने के लिए सजेस्ट करेंगे एंड हाउ डू यू नॉर्मली लुक एट स्टार्टअप्स, अर्ली स्टेज स्टार्टअप्स को आप कैसे देखते हैं, वैल्यूएट कैसे करते हैं, व्हाट इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट फैक्टर दैट कम्स इनटू प्ले व्हेन यू डिसाइड टू इन्वेस्ट इन अर्ली स्टेज स्टार्टअप, बिकॉज लेट्स बी ऑनेस्ट ये स्टेज पे आप स्टार्टअप का वैल्यूएशन और फाइनेंशियल देख के तो इन्वेस्ट कोई नहीं करता है. सो ओवर टू यू, एक आपका छोटा सा इंट्रोडक्शन. And then we can get ahead with the session.
Thanks, Shreyas. Thanks, Agrika. And it is pleasure to essentially discuss. It's always good to have a conversation. मेरी कहानी भी बड़ी मतलब टेढ़ी मेढ़ी से है. So yesterday I was discussing with somebody कि कितना ज़्यादा planning से मैंने ये सब किया. तो that person was saying, अरे तुमने तो बहुत प्लान किया था, ये वो ऐसा ऐसा एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट. आई सेड बॉस, देयर वाज नथिंग व्हिच वाज देयर. आई कैन टेल यू, आई कैन वाउच फॉर द फैक्ट दैट देयर वाज नथिंग इन व्हाटएवर इज टुडे, देयर वाज नथिंग व्हिच वाज प्लान्ड इन दैट. सॉरी, दिस वाज आल्सो नॉट प्लान्ड. एंड दिस इज द क्लासिक केस ऑफ एनी ऑफ द हर्डल दैट द स्टार्टअप मे फेस. सो वी स्टार्टेड दिस कॉन्वर्सेशन. The conversation ideally is supposed to be noise-free in a clear environment, and then suddenly you get a hit from an external environment and you had no idea that where is it going to be. And that's the exact piece in the startup's life. You believe that you are in a comfortable environment. Is room ke andar ho, sab kuch perfect hai, sab badhiya chal raha hai. Aapne apne ghar ke TV ko band kar diya hai, dusre ghar ke baaki logon ko dusre kamre mein band kar diya hai. Aapke hisab se noise nahi hai, but suddenly you have somebody who is kind of constructing metro line and is throwing left, right and center machine which you have no control of. Exactly, this is the situation of a RB state startup.
Interesting, pretty interesting comparison.
And that's where essentially things go. And when I look at things in that context, when I started, I had absolutely no idea that where is it going to go. I had one kind of a bit translucent kind of, or opaque if you may want to say, a bit of an opaque view of the world that that's where I want to go, and I was heading in that direction. That's it. So mm-hmm. What do? We essentially run an entity called the FinTech Meetup. We believe that we are in existence wherein the purpose is to be able to catalyze the journey of an early stage startup. That's what we essentially do. So that's a brief about us. Now, let me try to kind of come back to the point which you had raised about what do we look at in an early stage startup. Yeah, सबसे पहली चीज तो जो हम देखते हैं कि बॉस, आदमी जब बोल रहा है उसकी जबान कितना दम है. मतलब मेरे ख्याल से पता नहीं, शायद थोड़ा सा मैं, एंड मे बी ऐसा हो सकता है कि कल की डेट में कोई जबान का धनी आए तो वो शायद हमको बेवकूफ भी बना ले जाए. बट सही मायनों में मैं जो देखता हूं, मैं जो ढूंढता हूं, शायद वो ढूंढता हूं ऊर्जा, या एसेंशियली व्हाट आई सर्च फॉर इज एनर्जी. व्हेन यू कम्युनिकेट, व्हेन यू टॉक, व्हेन यू प्रेजेंट, व्हेन यू शेयर व्हाट यू डू, and how much of what you are stating is something which is lyrical, comes on and on and on and on and on without what does that mean is how much you have kind of, it is inside you. If you are living an idea and you cannot, Hindi mein usko bolte hai, ek shabd hai, dhara pravah. यदि आप किसी विचार से प्रेरित हैं और साला तुम उसके बारे में 5 मिनट धारा प्रवाह नहीं बोल सकते हो तो तुम किसी काम के नहीं हो मेरे हिसाब से. सो दैट्स व्हाट फर्स्ट एंड फॉरमोस्ट आई लुक एट इन एनी स्टार्टअप. that how much the founder comes with conviction in stating what they believe and how they state it, to my mind, captures everything else. So, and I've seen that kind of on a very, very consistent basis. It was August 2018. We were coming from Yatra of that year, and Nasik was the stop. And when we stopped at Nasik, we met with a very, very early stage startup, which we now know as Jai Kisaan. And the founder, Adriel, when he walked into the room, and then he spoke for next 35 minutes or so, whatever that period was, it was absolute flow. He was absurdly clear on what he wants to do. For me, your ability to narrate what you believe in, your ability to narrate it without a OAA, and your ability to present your vision and being able to create that vision exactly in the same manner in the eyes of the person who is talking to you is the foundation of everything when I look at early stage startup. So that's kind of a bit of a longish answer on what I look at when I look at a startup.
Interesting. So, ये स्टेज पे अगर आप किसी अर्ली स्टेज स्टार्टअप को मिलता है तो आप ना उनका मतलब फर्स्ट इंप्रेशन जो है वो बंदा कैसे बोल रहा है, द कन्विक्शन इनसाइड हिम इज व्हाट मैटर्स, आइडिया एंड फाइनेंशियल्स और वो सब चीजें बाद में आती है, इज दैट हाउ यू लुक एट इट?
नहीं देखो यार, ऐसा है कि मूल तो आइडिया ही है ना, खुराफात की सारी जड़ तो वही है ना, खुराफात का बीज जो है वो तो उस आइडिया से ही आया है ना. Essentially to say that it is that idea which drives individual, and how driven you are is a function of how you state that, and therefore it is how you state and present your idea is what defines to me how you are going to build it. When you are at a later stage, there are so many more things. You have financials to back what you are stating, you have a project plan, you have a GTM, you have so many more things. But when you are such an early stage organization, what you have is your principal conviction in the idea and how far you can go in making it a reality. That is the key. So your belief in idea is the foundational piece. There's no two thoughts about it.
So let's put forward a trivia question for you. Say if two founders are working on a similar idea, one founder has a good conviction along with not so well financials, and the other founder has good financials but not a very good conviction. Which way would you go?
The one with conviction. No two thoughts. And that is something which I have done on many occasions, wherein I have kind of betted on people with conviction rather than betting on people with peripheral pieces. That is something which I remember last year when we had to take a call on an HRMS platform. At that point of time, we had a possibility of betting on somebody who had much better financials. But then we still decided to bet on somebody who had much greater conviction. Because the point is that you can bring rest everything else, but where from will you bring conviction? Conviction in what you are going to build is what you stand for. And you stand for that come what may. That's where it should be all about. And when you have that strong a conviction, you're good with the idea of accepting your failures. You're good with the idea of moving ahead with your successes and so. That becomes the principal piece for everything.
Bilkul. So यहाँ पे how would you evaluate an idea? Because even the idea that might not be feasible at certain point can drive a person with conviction. A person can be driven with this kind of an idea. How would you identify this kind of a situation?
So, okay, once you have established that the person is with conviction or not, whether the founders have the conviction or not, then of course comes the next step of evaluating the idea in the current scheme of things. Now that's where essentially your domain expertise comes. When you meet up with so many startups, so many founders and so forth, at some point of time, you essentially reach a point wherein you can say that this idea, in the journey of this idea, these are the friction points. and how much those friction points are removable, and they do not represent essentially building a new behavior. If they are not as much about building a new behavior, but catalyzing the existing value chain, the possibility that it will move faster is on a higher side. So therefore, after you have looked upon a founder, you need to look upon the idea, its applicability, at what pace and rate it can be kind of catalyzed in market, and do you have right kind of network to help them catalyze. We foundationally believe that we do not just invest upon the founder's ability to grow, but also in our ability to help them grow. And because we do that, because we essentially do this, wherein the view is that we will invest on founder's ability to grow as well as our ability to help them grow. So it's a journey which involves both the pieces coming together. So I need to like the founder. He needs to have conviction on what he's building. The idea should have a market potential in the current scheme of things from a current regulatory environment framework point of view. Unfortunately, BFSI is extremely regulated. So it should have our current regulatory framework point of view. And fourth is the fact that we at Yan should believe that we have the right kind of levers to be able to add value to them. An early stage founder does not require a dumb capital. It requires three elements. That's what I believe. It requires knowledge capital, distribution capital, financial capital. We intend to bring all of them. We bring our subject matter expertise. We bring our distribution strength. And then we bring our financial strength. We are not large investors. We possibly invest $100,000 to $200,000 or so. As we are not large investors, it is extremely important for us to be able to invest our small money in organizations wherein our fundamental thesis fits in, and the belief in the founder's conviction is a shared belief at our end.
One very interesting point that you mentioned here is that how you bring value to founders when you invest in them, apart from the money part. How important is it for the founders to kind of find the investors that add value to them apart from the money? Because at a stage when you are in a very strict financial crunch, you would easily get influenced by an investor who's ready to put in heavy money in you without bringing anything else on plate. So what does the value add mean to a founder?
So frankly, from a founder's standpoint, yes, I seriously appreciate that they have a lot of challenge in identifying right kind of capital. As I said, that for me, the capital should have all those three elements. But then not many of them get that. Say, for example, we also possibly looked at some 967 startups last year. We finally ended up working with 10. But maybe 40 were right, and so on and so forth. So which means that there will be other type of investors which the founders will essentially have to find a way to get connected. Not every founder will be in a position to find the right kind of investors. My view is this, that if at least a founder should give it a try to bring an investor who brings all of this. Which means that if you are, say, for example, hypothetically, you are working on a product which is, say, in credit cards industry. Now, if you are working on a product which is in credit card industry as a domain, then you should try to identify, one, people who have the background in credit card industry and they have the network in the credit card industry which can help you move. So a $20,000 from somebody who has been in the industry is far more valuable versus a $50,000 from somebody who is essentially a financial investor only. So it's a tough call, but from a founder's perspective, a founder should always, in his initial stage of life, should do this, that they should prepare a list of institutions and individuals they should try to identify and work with, And these are the ones who bring those three things: knowledge capital, distribution capital, financial capital. So getting money from them is a far, far, far better thing to do versus getting money from others. So therefore, my perspective simply will be that the founders should essentially draw up a list, approach such people, present their vision, and try to see that if hypothetically they are raising $250,000, at least 50% of that can come from people from industry. That will also reflect industry's conviction in their product even before they are in market. That's something which is essential, which will help them in terms of building their distribution, product, outreach much faster.
Does that also, so having an industry specialist as your investor and someone who trusts in your startup, does that also add value to your startup when you're going to raise a follow-up round going ahead?
So by the time you actually go to follow-up round, the industry expert would have already added value. What do I mean by that? Say, for example, somebody who has been, like say myself, I have been in industry now for 16 years, right? In 16 years, I worked with ICICI, I worked with HSBC, I worked with Yes Bank, I worked with Vodafone M-Pesa, I worked with Visa. I worked with five organizations in my 15, 16 years of career. Actually, 13 years because I left 3 years back. So in those 13 years, I worked with five organizations. Now, multiple people in these organizations have grown and become seniors in their own organizations, or they are either running on their own or they are business heads or domain heads and others in different organizations. Now, all of these people represent my network. I would have, say, a network of 50 odd further people and so on and so forth. Now, because we are in the business of doing this, we have a network of, say, 100 more people of such nature. This network, essentially, when it comes together for this entity, it helps them multiply during that period itself. So by the time you are actually going for your next round, which is a venture investor round, thinking that the first round was an angel investment round and this the next one is a venture investor round, when you go to the venture investor at that point of time, your distribution value chain has already got a lot of value, because you had people who have enough and more connects in the industry. I have heard of stories wherein founders have waited for hours and hours and hours to meet up with right people, not even knowing that whether they are right people or not. They just simply went by designations, only realizing at a later point of time, nahi, wo toh right people thi nahi, and so on and so forth. So therefore, you need to essentially see that how much of the time that can get saved, how much of effort that can get saved, and so on and so forth. All of that would have already added value to the organization by the time it went to the next round.
Okay, so I had one question, right? In past couple of years, we have seen a couple of startups shutting down. And one of the reasons was that the investors were not right and they were not able to understand the business implications and how that would function. And at the time when they were getting funded, we saw how excited they were about it and how they took that decision and all of that. So looking back at that particular piece, how would you, essentially someone who is holding a term sheet about to sign, how will you tell them to essentially, look at the investors and how to identify the one that's right for you?
So I kind of remember, one of the first investment that I made, actually. So we have made till now 8 investments. Out of which, actually, the first investment that I made is something which is shut now. That was the only investment that I made in my personal capacity. Rest all were when we essentially brought institutions together and Yann as such as a value chain together. So frankly, when you are looking at from a startup's point of view, you're not just looking at bringing people as investors. You should also be ready with the idea of being able to take the learnings provided by these individuals and being able to actually implement those learnings. One of the biggest challenges that I faced in the first startup that I funded was the fact that I would say 10 things to the founder and he would kind of agree on all those 10 things, but he actually never implemented And that happened on a very, very consistent basis. Now, therefore, that's where also one needs to see that over a period of time, of course, you start observing, and over the period of time, kind of you start becoming clearer with that, that how much of the founder has the willingness and ability to learn and get his hands dirty in market, in essentially trying to implement something new, which otherwise was not getting implemented. Say, today morning only, I was giving a feedback to somebody in UK, and that gentleman is working with a large fintech in UK. And I was giving him feedback that, boss, one of these startups which we are common investors with, I was telling him ki yaar, they are not at all making efforts in terms of making themselves visible in the current value chain. And their competition is making consistent effort in doing that. And I was telling him that I have told them multiple times in last 1 year, ki boss, you need to up your game from the point of view of communicating it right. And that is something which is required, but they are not doing that. So I was just telling him that you also make a push from your side. So I think at times you need to kind of up the game as investors. You need to also see that the founders who are there, they should essentially be hearing you out. And if what you are stating makes sense, you should also try to push them to do that, because that is needed. Because if you are not just financial investor and you want your skin in the game, you should essentially make efforts to kind of mobilize, to push them to do things which otherwise they have not done. So I think it is a two-way street, from a founder as well as from a startup point of view, from an investor point of view.
Bilkul, got it. So circling back to the initial piece, I think you have seen more than around 2,000 pitches in last 3 years. So what is the most common mistake that these startup founders make when pitching to the investors?
Pitch deck hi dhang ka nahi banate hain yaar. So I think sabse badi cheez what I have seen missing is that people actually do not put much of effort in making their pitch deck. A pitch deck, if actually one invests right time, is actually a month activity. And people I have seen on an ongoing basis consistently, they do not make their pitch decks right. Most of the times, pitch decks are product catalogs. You are not selling a product out there. You are selling an organization's vision. And unfortunately, most of them also do not have a vision. At least from a vision's perspective, your vision should be grand enough, big enough, which is driven by no limitations of capital, technology, people, market, and other things. Most of the times, at least in Indian founders, I have found that the vision and the scale of thought process itself goes for a toss. It is extremely difficult to actually get them to think differently. I have seen that on ongoing basis, that they do not do that. And it took, and it's not just in an early stage case. I'm helping a startup to kind of make their pitch ready for a Series B. Even in their case, which is a very, very well-established startup and everything, even in their case, establishing a large vision itself is a big problem. So in my mind, pitch deck or how you communicate your pitch is something which is a clear big miss. And then having a large enough vision which kind of motivates, excites people around you is again a big miss.
So deep diving into the pitch deck a bit more. Sorry. What are some of the things that you have found missing most of the times? Yaar, ye cheeze honi chahiye, ye investors ko aapko dikhana hai, but sala 90% of the times koi hota hi nahi wo pitch deck, wo numbers ya wo cheez wo dikhana chahiye wo.
Tumne wo dekhi Sherlock Holmes. अभी जो रिसेंट वाली सीरीज आई है ना, जो मतलब नॉट मतलब वो जो मूवीज जो आई हैं, उसमें क्या होता है कि जो शेरलॉक होम्स होता है वो पहले ही मूव जो है वो अपने अपोनेंट के मूव जो है वो मेजर कर रहे थे कि ऐसे करेगा तो ऐसे करेगा, ऐसे करेगा तो मैं इसको उधर से फेंक दूंगा, पानी फेंक दूंगा एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट। सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज जो है वो ये है कि व्हेन यू आर पुटिंग टुगेदर द पिच डेक, इन दैट पिच डेक द बिगेस्ट पीस विच गोज मिसिंग इन मोस्ट ऑफ द वैल्यू चेन्स इज दैट दे बिलीव दैट द वीसी इज शेरलॉक होम्स। उसको तो पहले से पता है, उसको तो सब पता है, वो जो है वो भगवान का आठवां अवतार है जिसको सब पता है, और चूंकि उसको सब पता है तो हमको जरूरत ही नहीं है उसको समझाने की कि हम कर क्या रहे हैं। तो हम सीधे मुद्दे की बात पे आ जाते हैं कि ये प्रॉब्लम है, ये हम सॉल्व कर रहे हैं और इतना पैसा चाहिए। नहीं, मेरे हिसाब से वीसी एज ए कम्युनिटी जो है उसको उसको जो जानकारी होती है वो बड़ी लिमिटेड ही होती है। It is our responsibility to ensure that the VC knows about the ecosystem and the market that we are talking about. A VC should know that what exactly is the ecosystem in which you are operating. So in my mind, the first slide is the company slide wherein you can put a logo, a few words, 3-4 words about what you are. Second slide is a vision slide. Third slide is where you have the responsibility of informing your VC what is the market like in which you are going to operate. So if you are going to operate, say, in transit and fuel as an ecosystem, it is your responsibility to help them understand what do you mean by transit. Is it mass transit? Is it public transit? What is it? And it is your responsibility to talk about what type of fuel you are talking about. Are you talking about consumer vehicle fueling, or you are talking about commercial vehicle, and so on and so on. So just giving a view of the ecosystem or the market in which you are going to operate. You are, and to be very clear, you are not talking about problem statement, neither solution statement. You are just giving them an overview of the market in which you are going to operate. Now, once you have done that, in my mind, the second slide is, the fourth slide is the persona. Now, if you are operating in a B2B environment, you will have a B2B persona, which can be, if say we go back to the fuel example, it can be the fuel petrol pump owner's persona. If it is B2C and you are selling, say, a credit card, it can be consumer persona. Help them understand what is the persona of the segment that you are going to work. Give them that idea. Again, you are not talking about problem statement, you are not talking about solution statement. Give a view. Petrol pump owner hai, 40 se 50 saal ka hoga, saal ka 15 se 20 crore ka turnover hoga, itni gaadiyan aati hain, ye hota hai, wo hota hai, and all of that. Now that you have established the ecosystem that you are operating in, come to the problem statements this ecosystem is facing. At this point of time, when you speak about problem statement, and because you have personified that value chain, people will be in a position to appreciate it better. Once you have personified that, once you have made it clear what problem statement that you are addressing, the next slide can be about what is a global equivalent of what you are doing out here and how they have solved that problem statement in that environment. Why is it important? Unfortunately, most of the times, our value chains, our investor value chains, and so on and so forth, and all of that, they do not have the wherewithal or ability to kind of look at extremely original ideas. They do look forward to a global comparative for what you are doing. And as they look forward to a global comparative on what you are doing, it kind of becomes imperative on you that if you have something, do share with that, do share with them. And there's no harm in doing so. So this slide kind of represents that how that problem statement is getting solved or got solved in a global environment and so on and so forth. Now that you have established that, come to the next slide wherein you are not talking about how you are solving. What is it which is unique about you? What are your numbers looking like? How you have essentially attacked the problem and so on and so forth. So that's what you are mentioning out here. from your standpoint that this is how my solution statement looks like. Now, this solution statement now, if you are an early stage organization, you have bootstrapped and you have built it on your own till this point of time. The next step in that is now give them a demo of the product. Most of the times I've seen that founders do not provide the demo. But yaar, agar banaya to dikhao na bhai, problem kya? So give a demo of the product that you have built. Now, once you have done that, what you have done? You have established the ecosystem. You have established the problem statement. You have established how it is getting solved globally. You have established how you are going to solve. Now, you can ask for money. And then, while you are asking for money, give them a clear view of the GTM. That I'm going to raise XX from you. In next 6 months time, this is how I'm going to work. This is how distribution is going to build. If it's a B2C story, this is how I'll acquire customers. These are the number of customers I'll acquire. This is the top line. This is the bottom line I intend to have, and so on and so forth. These are the number of distribution channels I will look at. That's my 6 month story. That's my 12 month story. And after 12 months, I will potentially go for next fundraise. It is important to give your upcoming VC an idea of when exactly you are looking to raise next round and what exactly is going to be the money that you are going to raise and what will be the picture will look like at that point of time when you will build that. So say, for example, you are raising 2 million now and you are going to lead to X number of customers, Y number of distribution touch points, Z number of top line, A number of bottom line. Now give a view that 12 months down the line, I'm going to raise, say, 8 million, 10 million. And at that point of time, this is going to be this, this is going to be this, this is going to be this, this is going to be this. So give a view of the product, GTM and everything at this point of time. Now, once you have established all of this, now go back to your all of your slides and now start placing the people who are part of founding team to tell that at this point of time, which is my GTM, at this point of time, this of my founder will play a role. This of my founder has a connect with distribution value chains. He has been with HPCL for last 20 years. He knows the entire distribution value chain and he can do that. This founder of mine has worked with that global startup which has done ABC and therefore he kind of brings a subject and a tech understanding and so forth and all of that. And that's what you kind of package and so forth. Finally, you come to the last slide wherein you go back to your larger vision that you talked about and you give an idea that this is the path that I'm going to follow to reach that larger vision. This in a bar chart manner, you can say that this is the line and this is how, this is where I stand. This is where your money will take me. And this is where I will go with the next round. And this is how I will reach that larger vision in a 4-5 years timeline or so. So you have completed and concluded that. This in totality is a 12 to 14 slider. You don't need to create a 40 slider, 20 slider, 25 slider to give a view of what is it which you are building.
Thank you. I think that was, yes, Sagrika, please go.
Yes, I was saying that was wonderful. I mean, I have observed quite a lot of early stage founders being overwhelmed before the investor presentation. So be it for the content of the pitch or, you know, the storytelling part and all, I think that was a very well inputted thing. Also, one question I would like to add here is that while you're mentioning 12 to 14 slide, a story that you have formed that you're going to put out, what is the time limit that we are looking out here, or is there no time limit as such while you're actually presenting to an investor?
I think a fair time limit of 15 minutes should be there to present what you are doing and around 15 minutes for a Q&A. Okay. For me, it's also about that how clearly you can communicate the vision. That becomes extremely important. If you are not in a position to clearly communicate what you are building from a vision point of view, I think most of the things in my mind kind of start forming in the VC's mind when you talk about the vision. And when you talk about that, it kind of helps them frame what you are going to build. It tops up on from there. You don't need to go into too many details and trying to explain things and so on and so forth. A one and a half minute each slide is good enough to cover 12 slides in a 15 minute day.
Interestingly, the way that you put this thing made me have that moment when you look back in the hindsight and you connect the dots, and that is when you realize here I've seen multiple startups pitches, right? And out of that, when you connect the dots right now, when I connected the dots, I realized ki, yaar, jinki pitches ye sari cheeze kar rahi thi, those startups are at a very different stage right now compared to the ones that we saw that we had to push and we had to otherwise mentor and get them on the track. But jo log ka starting se, from the conviction point of view, the pitch deck point of view and all the other elements that we spoke of, those already had it in the first place are at a stage that we probably wouldn't have thought ki wo pahunchenge bhi.
Yeah, so that's correct. But aisa hai na ki, dekho, it's to say that not everyone can frame everything at some point of time. Of course, those who can, the success rate of theirs will be at a much, much different value chain altogether. But then there are still people who can be coached and kind of trained and kind of made ready for next things in life. So therefore, the belief is this, that you need to essentially kind of, you should be able to identify people who are coachable. Jo coachable nahi hai, to us pe to phir baat hi ho raha hai. Maine bahut saal pehle, I think 2004 mein jab main internship kar raha tha Idea mein, tab maine Idea ki meri summer internship ki kitab mein likha tha ki jab gadhi se dil lagaya to galib bezaar ho jayega. Ye us samay par maine likha tha. जिसका मतलब सिर्फ इतना था कि भाई अब अगर तुमने गधी से ही दिल लगा लिया है तो अब गलती तुम्हारी ही है. तो बेसिकली ऐसा है कि यू नीड टू बी एबल टू आल्सो आइडेंटिफाई दैट यार वेदर समबडी इज कोचेबल और नॉट. सो इफ समबडी इज नॉट कोचेबल यू शुड स्टॉप एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम. बट देन देयर विल बी ऑलवेज पीपल हु आर कोचेबल एंड हु कैन बी ट्रेन्ड एंड हु कैन बी मेड ग्रेट ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम. आई ओ व्हाटएवर आई एम to also to a very, very large extent to the bosses that I had in my formative years from 2005 to 2008. They gave me an absurd level of freedom to do things the way I wanted to do. And therefore, it helped in shaping me who am I today. So therefore, a lot of who you can be is also a function of how you build your foundation. And therefore, somebody like me who was more of a 5-point someone, for me to stand today at this stage and so on and so forth is an interesting journey on its own. But I owe a lot of this journey to people who kind of handholded me, or actually not handholded, they kind of made my life miserable from 2005 to 2008. But those who made my life miserable between 2005 to 2008, they are the ones to whom I owe today whatever I could get. So therefore, I was not among the classic people who have all the traits in them from day one. I kind of built the foundation over a period of time. So therefore, my belief is that there are always certain set of people who can be built, trained, coached over a period of time. At the same point of time, the hustle is something what you need to see in them. If you are coaching somebody and you can see them hustle, then you are coaching the right person. If you don't see hustle, then that's the person you should not waste your time.
Since we have touched this chord, I would request you to delve a bit deeper into your a bit more of your history and how you reached where you are, the visa experience, the M-Pesa experience and all of that, since you have played crucial roles in the international initiative, sir.
Okay, so I'll try to keep it brief largely for the purpose of the context of this conversation. But okay. So, and this is something which I have been kind of thinking for quite some time, that what forms who you are as such. So what forms who you are, you can always trace it back to your early childhood. And that kind of gives an indication of who you were at that point of time. And that's the reason why you are who you are today. So I was somebody who in my early childhood was an absurdly curious individual. who would make efforts to kind of read newspapers. At the age of 7 or 8, I would read newspapers, take out interesting trivia from newspaper and write it in my book. I had a diary, I would write it in my book. And I would do that diligently for years. So therefore, I knew a lot of trivia. I knew a lot of things. So I always had the ability to create stories. This ability to create stories came from the curiosity to search for unique stories. And that curiosity to search for unique stories happened because I was reading. I was reading at a very early stage. I was reading to such an extent that I used to kind of steal money from my parents' pocket to essentially go out and buy comics, buy books and others. And I would go up to that extent. A kid of 7 years old, a 7-year-old kid traveling a distance of around 5 kilometers, essentially walking a distance of 5 kilometers, going to a shop, stealing money from his father's pocket and buying a comic book, essentially made me so much more independent. So when I look back at that kid who was just 7 years old, he would steal money from his father's pocket, would go to a shop 5 kilometers away, will buy a book, come back, read that book and all of that. It amazes me today because आज की डेट में शायद माँ बाप अपने 5 साल 7 साल के बच्चे को शायद उतना दूर, मेरे घर वालों को तो पता भी नहीं होता था कि मैं ये कर रहा हूँ। मैं अगर पिताजी की जेब से पैसा चोरी कर रहा हूँ तो कैसे मालूम होगा? ऑफ कोर्स मैंने बाद में बहुत मार खाई as they started realizing that, but then essentially to say that the curiosity, the desire to kind of break away from comforts and the need to read, these three things were there in me at the age of 7. That continued and that continues. So every single damn thing which I look, even if I'll see a billboard which has something new, in my mind it is a question to me, so I need to solve it. So I will immediately go back, look at Google, that what does that mean? What is that billboard all about? And so on and so forth. So that curiosity is the primary factor for whatever I put. Then the ability to take risk, and then the reading desire essentially led to ability to create stories. So someone who is creative, someone who is curious, someone who can create stories, and someone who can take risk is what summarizes me today. And is something which now when I look back, to me, a 7-year-old, that's what summarized me back then as well. And that has remained. So I won't get into each of my corporate career phases, but each one of them reflected exactly the same thing.
I think we experienced one of that right at the start of this conversation when you were able to relate a metro work to the conversation. So I think that presence of mind is commendable. Yes,
it's essentially being curious with your surroundings, being able to actually relate with your surroundings, being able to live your surroundings. That's the reason why I have been a consistent believer of the fact that just watch human life. Just walk around, just walk and just see and just observe human life. The more you will observe that, the greater stories you will find around you, in and around you. You will find unlimited stories. The problem is that we have stopped being the story seekers. We have stopped being that. And that's where the problem lies, in my mind, as to why we haven't been able to create or craft communication.
I think I just connected one of the dots. I don't know if I'm right or not, but this inherent ability and the need to find and connect stories is what is making you so successful in identifying the right kind of startups, because you identify the stories over there that we are not able to.
For me, it's about human stories. Because at the end of the day, what is a startup? A startup essentially is going to be a someday a reality of somebody else's conviction. And if it is going to be that, then how much of the conviction that an individual holds can only come by knowing their stories. If you can know their stories, it kind of solves for many, many more things that you can essentially build on top of. You need to know their stories. You need to know that why a particular individual who was a backbencher at IIT Roorkee, because of one instance, became a gold medalist the next year, and so and so forth and all of that. And then he continued to remain gold medalist for all years, and then he became a gold medalist again when he went to IIM Bangalore. So therefore, you need to know those stories, and it is those stories that give you underlying of who they are. And that is important. You need to know the story of Wim Vishore, where you need to know that that guy was at a miserable point of failure. He was about to shut down his startup, and from that moment, how he rose, and so on and so forth. So therefore, in that scheme of things, I will be more than willing to bet on people, even if that means that maybe tomorrow again the startup shuts, but then willing to bet on people who have this conviction and ability to bring things to life from the worst of the circumstances in which they were. And that's important to find.
So I think if I were to summarize this entire conversation that we had today on how would you identify an early stage startup, it's all about the person, the conviction that they have, and the conviction with which they are able to express their ideas and how driven they are because of it.
Yeah, I shouldn't care a damn in terms of who is... I shouldn't care a damn for anything when I'm presenting my idea. Largely for the reason that if that person selects, great. If that person doesn't select, that's also great. Largely for the reason that, boss, I did not leave my job with the view that this specific opportunity, if it doesn't happen, that I'm screwed, then you are screwed in any case. You left your job, or you left your cushion, or you left your comfort to do things because you wanted to do them. And you will do that come what may. The world in any case doesn't care for what you do unless you succeed. And if the world doesn't care, why the heck you should care for the world? You should do what you believe with utmost conviction in what you are trying to do. Of course, you should not be dumb enough to push a Qutub Minar to say that I'll throw it down someday. You should not do that, but of course, you should have a clear view on being able to take up, define, decide, and then push forward with all your might. Again and again and again and again and again and again and again. As simple as that. That's the only way out. There's no other way possible.
Bilkul. So I think this was a really insightful and a candid conversation. Matlab, no holds barred. Maza aa gaya, it was a really good conversation. I think we essentially highlighted some points. So aaj tak shayad kabhi discuss nahi honge. So it was really brilliant. Thank you so much for your time. It was really amazing. Thank you so much.
बहुत बहुत ज्यादा से बढ़िया है और क्या कहते हैं उसे देखो ये सारी चीजें जो है ना वो सारी चीजें आई थिंक बॉइल डाउन इस बात पर जाकर के हो जाती हैं कि आप क्या करना चाहते हो और यदि आपको अपने जीवन में बहुत ज्यादा जो है वो इस बात से आप ड्रिवन नहीं हो कि आपकी फाइनेंशियल मॉनेटरी या अदर सक्सेसेस आपको डिफाइन करेंगी यदि आपको दिन में आप उतना कमा सकते हो जितना आपको सफिशियंट रख सके और सफिशियंट की कोई लिमिट नहीं है वैसे है ना क्योंकि डाबर हनी जो है वो 90 रुपए का 100 ग्राम आता है और एक मैं कुछ दिनों पहले एक दूसरा हनी देख रहा था एक दूसरा कोई ब्रांड देख रहा था मैं कहीं का वो साला 10,000 रुपए का 100 ग्राम आता है तो जीवन में आशाओं वो क्या तो जिसको ग्रीड है ना उसकी कोई लिमिट नहीं है तो ये बहुत जरूरी है कि आप ये डिफाइन करो कि भाई हम किस चीज के साथ जीना चाहते हैं और जिस चीज के साथ जीना चाहते हो उसके साथ जियो फिर बाकी फर्क नहीं पड़ता जमाने से है ना उस बात से इस बात का कोई फर्क ही नहीं है कि आप कहाँ और कैसे और किस तरीके से वो उसको आगे ले जाओ एक रामधारी सिंह दिनकर साहब की कविता है उसकी कुछ पंक्तियों के साथ में अपन इसको खत्म करते हैं रामधारी सिंह दिनकर साहब ने बहुत समय पहले इस कविता को लिखा था जिसके बोल हैं कलम आज उनकी जय बोल कलम आज उनकी जय बोल, चला अस्थियां बारी बारी, चिटकाई जिनमें चिंगारी, जो चढ़ गए पुण्य वेदी पे बिना दिए गर्दन का मोल, कलम आज उनकी जय बोल, जो अगणित लघुदीप हमारे तूफानों में एक किनारे, चल जलाकर बुझ गए किसी दिन, मांगे नहीं स्नेह मुंह खोल, कलम आज उनकी जय गोल, पीकर जिनकी लाल शिखाएं उगल रही सौ लपट दिशाएं, जिनके सिंह नाद से सहमी धरती रही अभी तक डोल, कलम आज उनकी जय बोल, कलम जो है उन्हीं की जय बोलेगी जो अपनी अस्थियां विसर्जित करने को तैयार है। और स्टार्टअप बिल्ड करना जो है वो एक हवन कुंड में अस्थियों की बलि डालना है, यदि वो अस्थियों की वेदी नहीं चढ़ा सकते हो तो ना बना पाओगे, चढ़ा दोगे तो दधीच हो जाओगे और तुम्हारे अस्त्र से जो है असुर का नाश हो जाएगा। तो कलम आज उनकी जय बोल, खत्म करते हैं। थैंक्स अ लॉट श्रेयस,
थैंक यू सो मच,
थैंक यू,
थैंक यू फॉर बीइंग हियर, थैंक यू सो मच।